preceding program was presented by the WWUH Community Affairs Department. The opinions expressed on this program do not necessarily reflect those of the staff or management of this station, WWUH, or the University of Hartford. Responsible opposing viewpoints are welcome.
600 spot on your dial. WICC, Bridgeport, Connecticut.
I'm Bud Finch, and I'll be back right after Andy Corona's news next over the sound of New Haven, WELI.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Steele of WTIC Hartford, speaking to you from the Army's Bradley Field in central Connecticut, where 25 or 30 big four-engine bombers have arrived in the past hour or so. More are coming in all the time.
The latest news from the WTHT Hartford Times newsroom.
Town Hartford, we bring you Hartford Speaks, transcribed. I'm Bob Maher, here's Una King.
Well, you bright little spring boy, you're anticipating it a little bit, aren't you?
That's number 83, everybody, at WTIC, at our Dickie Robinson Countdown Show, as we check out the top 100 records for 1967.
The Ken Griffin Show, WPOP.
From high atop Radio Mountain at 95.7, this is WBMI Hartford, Meriden. My name is Dan Bloom.
Connecticut Radio Memories, a series chronicling the first six decades of Connecticut's radio stations, as told by the people behind the microphones and behind the scenes. Episode 3, Radio Under the Umbrella, Part 1, The Radio Stations of the Travelers Insurance Company.
Radio before television.
Bill Hennessey.
Was totally different. I remember as a kid growing up in Nashua, New Hampshire with my grandparents, driving up to Manchester to see a live show on WFEA. It was in the Hotel Carpenter, which was a big building in Manchester at the time. And the audience was very attentive, and everybody on stage was dressed in tuxedos and gowns, and it was radio. And I've forgotten what the show was, but that's how radio was, and that's how it was at TIC.
WTIC, which stands for Travelers Insurance Company, I believe went on the air in 1925.
Former WTIC engineer Fred Pearson.
And it went on the air as a tax write-off to have some place to funnel money away. And darned if it didn't start making a profit.
Fortunately, you get a chance to read the charter that was filed with the FCC for the license in 1925 when it was granted.
Former WTIC sales executive Bob Dunn.
And when you read it, you realize that obviously this was a business opportunity, but there were people who were a part of that in the writing of that application and that charter who really felt a commitment to the community and an importance to inform and really treat that 50,000 watts on the AM side, particularly initially, with a service attitude to the community. And oh yeah, by the way, it should be a profit center. But when Travelers launched the station, that was not the top of the list of why they were going on the air.
Bob Ellsworth.
The original home of WTIC was American Row, 6th floor, Travelers Building.
They started on the 6th floor of 26 Grove Street.
Radio historian Bob Paine.
They actually started testing before their official sign-on on February 10th, 1925. They did two broadcasts in December of 24, and those were just experimental, and they featured folks from the Travelers Insurance Company.
In a 1950 anniversary program, Gertrude McCaulliffe recalled participating in the first official WTIC broadcast in 1925.
Well, I remember that I sang the ski song. Of course, it was the middle of winter, and the ski song's a good song for that. The snow was on the ground. Mm-hmm. And I think I sang Last Night the Nightingale Woke Me. I remember that was another song. Otherwise, I don't remember too much about it, except that I was very excited.
I'll bet you were. What time of day was this?
This was in the evening. Mm-hmm. I think it was an 8 o'clock or 8:30 program. And Mr. and Mrs. Coles were here. He was vice president. They called him the father of the radio. He was very anxious to have the station. He was very proud of it.
Though no recording of that first program exists, some of the same people were involved in this 1929 program, commemorating the final use of transmitting equipment at WTIC's Grove Street Studios in Hartford. That equipment became obsolete when the transmitting site on Avon Mountain became operational.
But because we see before us the new and vastly improved opportunity to better serve the public and earn a lasting and sincere goodwill, this is WTIC, the broadcasting service of the Travelers Insurance Company, the Travelers Indemnity Company, and the Travelers Fire Insurance Company, operated by the owner, for the owner, by the Travelers Broadcasting Service Corporation, all of Hartford, Connecticut.
Vice President W.D. Coles of the Travelers Insurance Company announced this final program
three original people who were in charge of that were Travelers Vice President Walter G. Coles, who was actually the first voice heard on WTIC. The other two engineers were J. Clayton Randall, who became the first chief engineer, I believe, that was his title, and Herman Taylor, who was the titles changed so much, but he was more or less the assistant chief engineer. And they continued with TIC, well, I think pretty much until their deaths in the early 60s. The gentleman by the name of Walter Johnson, who became the first official announcer of WTIC, the first staff announcer.
Again, Gertrude McCaulliffe.
Well, we had two studios. The large one was in blue velvet. The walls were hung in heavy folds, blue velvet rug on the floor, the windows covered, and when you sang into the microphone, you felt as if you were singing into a clothes closet full of clothes. The resonance was to go into the microphone, not into the room. The small room was in rose velvet. And we were given a folder in those days that told us, among other things, that we must dress as for a scene audience. So in the evening, you wore long dresses. You were dressed up, even though there were no spectators. It was all right. It gave us a feeling of the station being rather important.
I was told time and time again that
Dick Bertel,
WTIC produced as many as 17 hours of network programming per week. Bruce Kern would tell me, or Ed Anderson, that you could walk down the hall in the old Grove Street building. Studio C would be on the air with some music show that was going out to NBC, but somebody else was doing a local program at the time that was going out only on WTIC. It was a busy place.
TIC had its own orchestra?
They would have a concert orchestra, and then they would break those musicians up into smaller groups so that they might have a dance band.
Norman Clothier and his orchestra,
right.
You know, this is the kind of thing they had there. And
you know, a trio playing in the afternoon or, you know, something like that. And I don't know whether those musicians were on staff full-time. My guess is they probably weren't, but I was told they were. I understand, and again, I don't know for sure, but in 1947, when they disbanded their concert orchestra, they had 100 musicians on the payroll. Can you imagine?
We had a fellow named Hal Kolb, K-O-L-B, who played the piano and the organ for background music for locally produced soap operas right there on WTIC.
It's medley time with Hal Kolb.
Yeah. Well, people were needed for organ music or the organ effects. Yeah. Hal Kolb was the one. And when I first got there, I used to do the noonday show with Hal Kolb. I was the announcer. That was you were breaking in. And you felt good about it because there was so much going on, so much live radio, you know. And they had a staff of people who did those kinds of things. Ed Begley Sr. was one of the actors in the WTIC Guy Hedlund Players.
Presenting Guy Hedlund and Company. Good evening, radio friends. We have an unusual story for you tonight entitled Time Turns Back. It's from the pen of Kurt Unkleback and will give us something interesting to ponder over, I think. How do you classify this story, Mr. Hedlund?
I don't, Paul. After the author told me it was a fantasy on destiny, I gave up. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, including, as always, our studio visitors. We are presenting tonight an experimental drama. We hope you find it interesting and provocative.
As our play opens, a man stands before a desk in the administration offices of a Midwestern university.
I beg your pardon?
Yes, sir. Can I be of service?
My name is Leslie Burke, class of 22. I'm looking for...
Not the Leslie Burke.
Well, I don't know how many Burkes are around the world.
I mean the novelist. You are the novelist.
Yes, I am. I'm looking for...
The president is busy, Mr. Burke. Oh, but I'm sure that when I tell him you're here...
Well, if you don't mind, we'll leave the president until later.
He did adaptations.
Guy Hedlund's daughter, Barbara Manstan.
But he did write a lot of his own script, or he'd take a theme from a story and then expand it. Most of his stories were, love stories or heroic stories. Never anything of great violence or anything like that. He liked to appeal to the better side of life. He had a beautiful voice, very romantic voice, and he always played the lead, no matter what the story was.
The drama, the Guy Hedlund players, fostered a lot of people to Hollywood, big names. She was a beautician on TV, Jan Miner. The great character actor who hit Hollywood, Ed Bagley, because his son is an actor as well. He came from the TIC Hedlund players.
And of course, Ed Bagley ended up with an Oscar out in California. And then Eddie O'Shea, who turned into Michael O'Shea when he got to California. And Louis Neistat became Louis Nye in California. There were others, so many, that he had taken. He just picked them up out of other jobs and just plain taught them to read.
One show that I like, I've only heard bits and pieces of it, called The Wrightville Daily Clarion.
It was a comedy skit, a 15-minute show, and, you know, they would have Paul Lucas, a wonderful, wonderful man who became program director following Leonard Patricelli in 1957, I think, wrote that show, and I guess perhaps also acted in it. He was one of the announcers on staff. And, yeah, with sound effects, organ music, the whole thing. It was like a network show.
The Wrightville Daily Clarion presents editor Elisha Wright, Sister Jane, and Cousin Zeke Peck. As we tune in on Wrightville now, we find that it is later the same day. Zeke decided to call Chief Johnson of the Wrightville Police Department, and that gentleman has at last arrived. The fact is, he's just entering the front door now.
Well, come in, Chief Johnson.
Well, hello, Zeke. Hi, Miss Wright.
Oh, evening, Chief Johnson.
Yeah, sorry, couldn't get here in the center, but been busy on investigation over there at schoolhouse.
Oh, is that so?
Yeah, yep. Somebody's been stealing racers in fourth grade room, and so I spent all afternoon over there trying to catch the culprits, but no luck. I imagine they must have got tipped off.
Well, Chief, I had tried to explain that this matter is pretty important.
What's that you got there?
Well, sir, I brought this suitcase down from our spare room.
Now, don't tell me you're going in for second story work.
Oh, no, Chief.
I'll handle this, Janie.
Before he hosted the TV game show Password, Alan Ludden did radio panel shows on WTIC.
Alan came along in the late 1940s and created a show called Mind Your Manners.
Fred Mahoney was a substitute host on Mind Your Manners when Alan Ludden was unavailable.
Well, it was a half-hour program. It consisted of a panel of three girls and three boys, and they were given questions that were submitted by the audience. For example, such questions like, should a boy or girl enter a revolving door first? Should 16-year-olds go steady? That's kind of outdated today. And questions like dating, etiquette, attitude, and parental conflicts. Alan was pretty busy in New York then doing College Quiz Bowl and the beginning of Password. Mr. Patricelli, who was a program director, he said, you know, we wonder whether you would like to take over Alan's show called Mind Your Manners. I was flabbergasted, but I did it for a number of weeks, and I enjoyed it very much.
And, of course, you know, Alan went on to New York and became very, very well-known. He became, in the 60s, one of the afternoon hosts of quiz programs on CBS. He was very, very well-known.
So what was happening on a national level on the networks was being done on a smaller scale, but not much smaller, right here in Hartford, on WTIC.
Fred Wade.
Floyd Richards.
Fred was very much respected as a former announcer, and he was the assistant chief announcer at the time, and he was a producer, and Fred was a wonderful personality.
Fred Wade used to sing. He had a great tenor voice, and he was part of that Norman Clodia Orchestra.
Presenting Hull's Hour of Cheer, and offering for your entertainment, the Four Royal Waiters.
With a sign on the table, and a good song ringing clear.
Your favorite voice in your favorite songs. Fred Wade.
Romance, romance may come with a spring or a fall.
Fred Wade, I always liked.
Longtime WTIC receptionist Kay Mahoney.
Because he was always funny, you know, being sort of naive, I guess it would not sort of, but naive. We girls who were just sort of new there, like Marge Wentworth and myself and Edie and a few of them, we'd walk down the hall and there was Studio F, and if Fred Wade was going by, he'd say, come on in here, I want to audition you girls. Oh, we thought that, oh, Lord. he'd be arrested now. I started in 1943.
Hey, Mahoney.
I heard that there was an opening there, and I went in, and it was in the fan mail department for the Woman's Radio Bazaar. And I did that when I first started, and then later I worked for Herman Taylor, who was the chief radio engineer at that time. And I didn't like that. It was nuts and bolts and all those terms that I just didn't understand. And I guess he was happy when I applied for the job for the receptionist, and I was able to get it, and I just loved it. I loved every minute of it.
The corporation that owned it was a subsidiary of the Travelers called Broadcast Plaza, Inc.
Bill Flower.
And Broadcast Plaza, Inc. could be a little bit, well, I'm not sure that bureaucratic is the right name, very corporate. And you did what the corporate policy was. And if you didn't know what the corporate policy was, you darn well better make sure you found out.
Bill Hennessey.
But TIC, it was run more like an insurance company operation.
Bill and I are of the same thought on that.
Arnold Dean.
They did have so many levels of executive control. And it was the Peter principle personified, too.
Yeah.
They would take some of the outstanding people and promote them till they got to the point where their head was underwater. And then they'd give them one more promotion, shunt them off to a side, give them a secretary and a title, and get somebody else to do the job. Many, many people who just went beyond their capabilities, but they didn't fire anybody unless it was for some really terrible thing.
TIC pretty much stayed the way it was, a very conservative, staid station.
They had some rules and regulations on what you could and couldn't do.
Former WTIC engineer Bob Scherago.
Anything that seemed to be controversial was not allowed.
In the Travelers' days, there was little room for error.
Bryant Thomas.
And there was a debate by Patricelli and Tyrol, the two executives the Travelers had appointed to run the place, when G. Fox first wanted to mention the word bra on the air in a commercial. And they had a three-day debate over whether this was going to happen, and finally they made them say brassiere instead of bra. So that's how tight it was.
A lot of the music that was played was very carefully screened. For example, one of the big songs of the 40s was Temptation. And if I remember correctly, we were allowed to play, now this was a very benign piece of music, as anybody who knows it knows, but we were allowed, if I remember correctly, we were allowed to play only instrumental versions of it because the lyrics were deemed to be too controversial.
There were two forms of music that were in play in those days.
Dick Bertel.
There was the Frank Sinatra and Ferranti and Teicher duo pianists, that kind of music, Percy Faith, Ray Conniff, and so forth. So we were able to play that music. And then there was the rock records that were being played by WDRC. Well, we didn't play any of those.
And at TIC, we would never play rock and roll. As a matter of fact, there was an edict, I don't know if it was ever in writing, but I remember hearing it, and I believe it to be true, that we would never play an Elvis Presley record on this station as long as I'm the program director. And I won't quote who that was, but that was supposedly a true statement, and I believe it.
The broadcasting industry, the marketing, the advertising, the music industry, the entertainment industry, is somewhat different than the insurance business.
Former WTIC sales executive Bob Dunn.
And from my perspective, and also at that point, I think the ownership's perspective. So while, for example, there were rules and regulations under Travelers, you were not to be in the building, a broadcast house, without a suit jacket or a sport jacket and tie on at all times. And that was based on the fact that you never knew who was going to walk through the building, and management was concerned that it could be a client or someone. Mm-hmm.
I remember once I had to go up to the fourth floor, the executive hangout, where all the big offices were, and I was working in my shirt sleeves on the third floor because it was warm there and we were busy. I raced upstairs to sign in for my vacation, and while I was there, Bob Tyrol walked out of his office, looked at me and said, "On the fourth floor, we wear our coats."
And I think I left, I'm not sure of the date I left, but it might have been in 62 or 63. And the reason I left is we had then TV, and we had moved over to Constitution Plaza. And the public relations director at the time thought it would be nice if I and the tour guides wore uniforms, and I chose not to wear a uniform, so
okay.
I left.
It was, going along with the dress code.
Former WTIC engineer Wayne Mulligan.
There was also another, I don't think it was written necessarily, but you did not wear your hair very long. It did not touch your ears, nor did it touch the collar of your shirt. And Lou Palmer decided that he was going to test the waters, if you will, and he let his hair grow a little bit longer. And at one point, he was called to Leonard Patricelli at that time. When I first went to work there, Paul Morency was still the manager. But at that time, Mr. Morency had retired, and Leonard Patricelli was the manager. And I remember Lou coming down from the fourth floor one day and, you know, putting his coat on, and he said he was called up there and chastised for the length of his hair. And I says, oh, you know, what did you say? And he says, I informed Mr. Patricelli that all things considered, I would prefer unemployment, and walked out.
Beginning sometime next week, I'm going to have a new assignment here on TIC Radio, working alongside of Bob Steele in the morning hours. I may be getting up at 3 o'clock in the morning, as a matter of fact. A newcomer to our staff, Mike Butts, will be in this seat from 2 to 6 each day on the afternoon edition, as well as Saturday Showcase. We'll see you one more time on the Showcase tomorrow morning, though, at 10 o'clock, right after the Bob Steele Show. This is Lou Palmer. Have a nice weekend and stay with us on 1080 WTIC Hartford.
Ben Hawthorne was the early morning man in WTIC.
Fred Swanson.
Going back to the 30s.
This is Ben Hawthorne with a cow and a word for you from Yankeeland, where July has just shoved June out the back door. Bessie wants you farmers who've swapped a scythe for a scimitar to know that the pasturage this summer is right good. Grass up to here.
The morning show that he used to do called the G. Fox Morning Watch.
Bill Hennessey.
It was only an hour, but he was identified with it, and it was his show.
And I flew too close to the floor on the job here at TIC, landed on one elbow, and shoved my landing gear into my fuselage.
He got drafted and went off to World War II.
I'll be on the listening end instead of the pushing end. I'm changing my trousers tomorrow, swapping my ice cream pants for rifle breeches in Uncle Sam's bean and mustard brown. So I'll be seeing you.
He went into the service. His wife did the program for a while, but then it was given to Steele.
A fellow named Bob Steele took it over. And the rest of that is history, too, because that became the basis for Steele building up not only his sports image, but his personality programming.
Good morning, everybody. How are you today? Ladies and gentlemen, and boys and girls, it looks like a nice morning. A beautiful morning here in Hartford. It looked pretty good yesterday morning, too, but had a little thunder and lightning and heavy rain for a spell there. Yesterday in Weathersfield, anyway. Imagine some of it hit you, but it looks beautiful this morning. It is Tuesday already. The 4th of May. This is Bob Steele, and that's Ben Zinkerman. Would you take a bow, Ben, and then try to play that first number? If you can't play it right, I'll show you how. Paloma Blanca. Danny Davis and the Nashville Brass.
Well, he joined the station in 36,
Bertel.
Took over the morning show in 1943, and was on the air until his death in 2002.
He was
Jim Rayner,
the perfect morning man. He had information, and he interspersed it with a little bit of dry humor, some entertaining music. Oh, maybe it was a little old-fashioned, yeah, but it got you into the morning with all the things that you needed to know smoothly.
24 after 8. Hope everything is going along smoothly where you are. Hope the kids are behaving. Are you kids behaving? That's good.
He had a very smooth and melodic voice.
Connecticut Broadcasting Association President Mike Rice.
And it was did a very slow-paced, calm, and methodical program that was the highest-rated program in the United States for many, many years.
Early in his years doing the morning watch and the
Bob Steele's son, Phil Steele.
Beginning in 1943, he had this sense of going into people's homes.
Sun is up, the dark is o'er. I am up too for the morning watch. How about you? Will you stick around and listen to me with the news and the time and the weather and stuff? I wish that you would hurry and comb your hair for breakfast. Look nice and have some oatmeal and don't hide behind that newspaper.
He'd be aware of what they were about, why they'd be have the radio on, why they'd be listening, you know, not just to tell a few jokes, but to kind of help them on their day.
If you're leaving the house right now, don't forget your letters, the ones you want to mail for sure today. You forgot them yesterday. Got your keys, operator's license, clean hanky, and did you take your vitamins?
He was, you know, always trying to be helpful to people.
If you came into the market from somewhere else and you'd listen to this, you'd say, how is this as powerful a morning guy or morning show as it is?
Leo Barrieau.
And it was one of those guys that everybody grew up with Bob. You loved his voice. You know, he was security.
Working with Bob Steele was like being on the Red Sox team with Ted Williams.
Bill Hennessey.
He was one of the players. He was one of the team members. But he was always special.
There were the staff announcers, and there was Bob. Bob would do his show, and then he would take off. He would go home. And he would come back in at night to do Strictly Sports, which was on, I think, at 6:15, and then he would leave again.
Hey, buddy, want to know the winner before he wins? Listen, my name's Steele, Bob Steele. Sometimes it's the kiss of death, but win or lose, it's a lot of fun when old Strictly makes a pick. Bob, for the job you did forecasting the 52 World Series, I understand you're being considered for a place in baseball's Hall of Fame.
Well, I don't think it'll pan out, Ross, frankly. I hear the fellow who's been sweeping the place out plans to stay for a while.
Dr. Fritz von Strubel.
The von Strubel Sports Survey is finished. When I would like to announce that WTIC's Bob Steele made a most impressive record picking winners of anybody all over the country. Friends, hear the great Bob Steele with Strictly Sports weekday evenings at 6:15.
He was always the guy of the TIC announcing staff. One of the guys, but he didn't have to do the same assignments as the rest of us because he became a very special personality very early in his career, and he remained so until the day he died.
Robert E. Lee Steele, just about ready to leave you all. It's about a minute of eight now, and that'll be it for this morning, friends. Before I drop off into space here, though, Herman Rogers, a Morning Watch listener of Wallingford, writes in to ask a question. I can't answer. Maybe some of you can. If a judge ate 12 dozen eggs, would that be a gross injustice? Gosh, I wouldn't know where to look up the answer to a question like that. Well, so much for the Morning Watch for this day. Till tomorrow morning at 7, this is your good friend and mine, Bob Steele, saying so long, admitting that our music is transcribed and recorded, and suggesting that you stay tuned for a 5-minute program presented by G. Fox.
The thing that impressed me about Bob Steele was his professionalism.
Bill Henry.
I always thought that if a network show wanted that kind of a record show in the morning, Bob Steele could have done it very easily. He had a tremendous degree of, I guess, consideration for the audience.
Bob Steele was something to work with.
Arnold Dean.
He was very demanding. He went on the air, and his feeling was he had such loyalty for his audience. Everything that happened between 5:30 and 10 in the morning was his responsibility. I owe my audience this. If you pronounce Wesleyan as Wesleyan on the news, I'm going to go on the air and say you mispronounced it. He was very defensive about satisfying his audience and doing everything right.
Former WTIC engineer Fred Pearson.
Never had a joke on the air that was off color.
The time 9 minutes before 8 on the 21st of March, first full day of spring, and it's going to rain today, they tell us. Yeah, we haven't had enough, huh? We have to have more rain. It'll certainly fill up the birdbath, that's one thing I'm sure of. You know, a good idea is to put a safety mat in the birdbath. We do in our house. My wife is always worried about accidents, you know, thinks of bird might sue us or something.
His humor was a humor that was funny and not off color and just quick. He was a fun guy to work with.
Bob Steele never wanted anything to do with equipment. Yeah. He would never have sat at a computer. He wanted two buttons in his studio. One says on, one says off.
It is a privilege to be here at this time, speak to you, thus alone. Hello, Dr. Downs. How are you? Dr. Downs with his operating kit. What's it going to be this morning? Appendectomy? Brain operation? What are you going to do this morning? He's got his kit there. He's getting all his tools laid out there and all the scalpels and sponges and everything. He's got his apron on. He's going to operate on this turntable, play a little music for us.
Of course, Bob Downs, he was pretty much Bob's engineer and stayed with him day in and day out.
Former WTIC engineer, John Reno.
But there were days that I did engineer the Bob Steele show, and along with a fellow by the name of Baxi Howell. There was another one, Ted Broussard, Dick Zwirko, and of course Bob Scherago.
Bob Downs was the primary engineer who worked Tuesday through Saturday, so I did Bob's show on Mondays.
Former WTIC engineer, Bob Scherago.
Intense, but a lot of fun. He seemed to be very loose and unprepared, and yet, in fact, he was extremely well prepared. He could deliver a commercial like nobody else could.
Suds will float out of the clothes you thought were detergent-free and clean. So the next time you do the wash, use Miracle White with your pre-soak and detergent. You'll be amazed at what the combination will do. Miracle White Super Cleaner, guaranteed to satisfy or double your money back from Miracle White. Look for the big blue bottle soon.
This is a guy who didn't wear headphones.
Chris Francis.
Who had a person playing records for him in the next room. And damned if he wasn't on time for every single element every time I worked with him. And it was amazing.
Let's throw our word for the day in here. One we've had before, but people keep mispronouncing it. The French words, expression coup de grace, a finishing stroke, is often, I would say more often than not, pronounced coup de grace, and it cannot be coup de grace. G-R-A-S is gras, G-R-A-C-E is grasse, and this is coup de grace.
When you're on the air and you have to say all this in front of, you know, hundreds of thousands of people, you want to try to do the best you can, get the best pronunciation you can. And he just took that so seriously that it became a feature of the Morning Watch program he started in 1943. He'd throw out a word, share it with his audience, you know, one of these words that he would overhear. He'd go out to talk and some professor would introduce him or the president of a bank would introduce him and mispronounce a word. Or Walter Cronkite would mispronounce a word, whoever it would be, wherever. You know, he would notice these things, and he would use that as the word for the day the next morning.
Respite, R-E-S-P-I-T-E. Respite, let's take a little respite, a rest. Looks like respite. Respite is correct.
But I miss him because his position at WTIC was chief announcer.
Former chief engineer of WTIC, Larry Titus.
Have you ever heard of anybody being called chief announcer? And what was the job of the chief announcer was to listen to the other people announcing and correct their speech patterns, their mispronunciations. They'd come to him because Steele with his word of the day thing was very much into the lexicon of English language and how people announced. And since I had taken courses in radio and television announcing, I appreciated that.
Even before he was chief announcer, I think he didn't hesitate because, I mean, and a lot of times I think many people resented him. They didn't, some of his colleagues, you know, professional people, not just people in radio or who are on the radio and think that they're good and that they know what they're doing, but all human beings, you know, we're very sensitive, and when other people correct us about anything, we often will, you know, resent it. My father didn't really understand that, I guess. He thought people ought to be really grateful because he would love it when other people would tell him something, you know, would correct him.
He was a stickler. Oh, man, if you made a mistake, you know, he would, you know, off the air, he'd run you into the ground, you know. So you really were on your toes when you worked with Bob. He was a perfectionist.
North and South Vietnam hitting two South Vietnamese outposts. On the political scene, the danger of civil war grows as government troops and dissident forces exchange gunfire in the city of Da Nang.
I was writing his news one morning. It was around 5:30. We're in the newsroom.
Former WTIC newsman Dewey Dow.
I'm rushing like crazy. Handed him his newscast last minute, and 2 minutes later, he yelled across the newsroom for me. I came over. He said, "How does this man like his name pronounced?" And I said, I'm not certain. He said, "I'm not going on the air with this name if you're uncertain. So why don't you find out?" I said, "Bob, it's 5:30 in the morning." He said, "Then wake him up," which I did. And happily, the man in question was very gracious.
I think that Bob carried it to extremes at times. There's a wonderful racer who for many years was very popular here. His name was Reggie Ruggiero. Now, Ruggiero was spelled R-U-G-G-I-E-R-O, but everybody pronounced, including Reggie and his family, pronounced it Ruggiero. And at Stafford Speedway, the call was Ruggiero, Reggie Ruggiero, you know. So one morning I'm doing the sports with Bob, and I said, "And Reggie Ruggiero was the winner of the event at Stafford last night." As soon as they went to a commercial, Steele said, "You have an Italian background, you know better. That name is not Ruggiero, it's Ruggiero." I said, "Bob, I realize that we're not on the earth." I said, "But unfortunately, his family pronounces it Ruggiero. All the race fans pronounce it Ruggiero. And if I go in and say Reggie Ruggiero, they're all going to think I'm an idiot. That's like saying it's not WC, it's Debussy."
Yeah.
You know, everybody's going to think I'm wrong, even if I happen to be right, which I would not be with WC.
Yeah.
But he said, "I'm telling you the name is Ruggiero, and that's the way it's going to be pronounced."
Word for the day is Westminster. Westminster Abbey. Don't put two eyes in Westminster. Quite often you hear Westminster. It isn't Minster. All right.
He would let you know it if you screwed up. He was good at that.
Bryant Thomas.
But, you know, generally, if he said you made a mistake, chances are you had.
He wasn't as sensitive about how to do this, I think, as he might have been. Growing up, he wouldn't hesitate to correct us, and sometimes he'd make you feel a little bit stupid. So, you know, you didn't welcome it. So I understand how people felt, because I felt some of that myself, I think.
There was nobody who couldn't learn from Bob Steele if you wanted to.
Found something rather interesting. What would you say is the first word in the dictionary? Except for the letter A, the first word of two letters, more than one letter. It's a Hawaiian word, and it's a kind of lava. A-A, pronounced ah-ah, with the accent on the first ah. Ah-ah. It's a kind of lava, a rough lava. It says it's contrasted with Pahoehoe, which must be a smooth lava. I don't know, but that's all it says.
He really was my mentor, Bob Steele.
Brad Davis.
He used to yell and scream at me, and, you know, when he did that, you knew he liked you.
Well, Bob was the man.
Floyd Richards.
When I got there, and Bob was such a wonderful person. He took me in tow as a complete rookie, and Bob was a if you didn't know him, he seemed like a very gruff person, but he was a very, very thoughtful person and very willing to help out somebody that would indeed help out the whole station. So in a way, I guess he was my mentor. And as you know, Bob came up from less than a lot of people did.
I remember when I came here, I arrived here at 2 o'clock in the morning, 10th of May, 1936. And I had 20 cents in my pocket, two thin dimes, and as I've said many times, I'm worth 10 times that today, so I don't have to worry.
And he made his own life, and he was quick to tell you if you were wrong, but he was quick to pat you on the back if you were right, too. So I think he certainly helped to fashion my career at WTIC, as he did so many others.
He took me under his wing, and
Richard Price,
you know, told me that someday I would be with one of the radio networks, which more or less don't exist anymore, and gave me a letter of recommendation. I mean, he was just a great guy and quite a mentor. I really miss him.
I have to tell you, the man was
was brilliant when it came to radio.
Greg Gilmartin.
I don't know that there are as many good announcers today as there as Bob Steele was. He had a subtlety. There was an intelligence to what he was trying to accomplish on the air. And just to be around that all the time was a wonderful feeling and certainly a great learning experience for myself. And
did you know that? You see how you found out something by listening to our program that you didn't know, and now you're happy. Some of you are. Some of you knew that already, and you don't want to be happy, huh? All right. Well, that's up to you. We try to make you happy. What are you playing here, Bob? Oh, this is Sugar Lips. Okay. This will make you happy. Bill Justice and his orchestra. Who said there was no justice? He's right here playing.
Well, I had the great privilege of being able to work with Bob Steele for probably one Saturday a month for the better part of maybe 2, maybe even 3 years. And it was like going back in time. I mean, I was one of the younger people at the radio station and certainly one of the younger news people there. And to be able to have been on the air with such a legend was truly a privilege. And just think that this is a guy who went back to the 30s. I mean, this is a guy who built that great radio station.
How do you like this one, folks? Joe Leahy and the orchestra and Arriba.
But he was a very kind man.
Longtime WTIC receptionist, Kay Mahoney.
As well as being a very witty and intelligent fellow. He did ride in one day or one afternoon on his motorcycle, so he took a few of us one by one around the block on his motorcycle. Well, that's the first and last motorcycle ride for me. It was only, I don't think it was half a second, you know, just around that one building in the Travelers.
Yeah, I had a 1975 BMW motorcycle and stopped by Bob's house. He lived in Wethersfield also. And having worked with him, I felt comfortable enough, and I would stop by his house once in a while to see how he was doing. And I knew he raced motorcycles in the old days, and when he came to Hartford, he was an announcer for a motorcycle track in Hartford.
A friend of mine who would have invited me to come here and hired me to do the motorcycle race announcing at Bulkley Stadium, just the public address work.
So I stopped by to see him on my new shiny 1975 BMW motorcycle, and his wife came to the door, and Bob came out, and he looked at the bike, and he hopped on it, started it up, and went zipping out the driveway, leaned it over to the side, and zoom off into the distance in the right. We hear the noise of him coming back on the road, and all of a sudden goes flying by the house, comes back a little while later, leans it over to the side, comes driving back in the driveway, puts it on the kickstand, and says, "Fred, that's a really nice bike." And his wife was standing there wringing her hands, you know. I don't think she appreciated the fact that I gave him my bike to take out for a ride, but I know he took it out, and that took him back quite a few years.
Cause yeah.
He rode those old strange bikes where the handlebars were about 3 feet apart and just small little thin tubing. So for him to drive a bike like that, I know he really appreciated it and had a good time.
Yeah, but he was an extraordinary gentleman. He was one of those guys who was great to know and great to enjoy. But one of the funniest things that Bob Steele always did is he'd offer you, if there was a tie that you'd like, he'd offer to buy the tie from you. You know, I'll give you $1 for that tie, and I'll give you $3 for 2 ties.
Once a year, he'd bring in some of his old ties. He loved to collect ties, or either given ties or bought ties, and he had a rack full of ties. And
former WTIC engineer, Dick Zwerko.
He'd have a sign out. He'd say, "The ties, a dollar a piece, and three for $4, or something like that." He'd sell his ties on a rack, and I still have one of his old ties that he had sold. I still hang on to it. I hate to, and once in a while I'll wear it. It's a good looking tie.
In just 1 minute, we're going to have no school announcements. Swimsuits in January, why not? Clap and Treat, New England's largest white stag Speedo swimsuit dealer, has the 74 line of Speedos just in time for the indoor swimming season.
Probably thing that people might think of more than anything else when they think of Bob Steele are the no school announcements.
Right.
Okay, let's look at our no school announcements here. First, we'll have one that's open. This is a correction. This was incorrect information originally, but now this is what you can believe. In Mansfield, schools will open 2 hours late, and there will be a 2-hour delay in buses to Wyndham Tech.
Now, you know, that's only, of course, when there's a snowstorm and there's school closings. But people remember that. It's interesting. A lot of people would think that, gee, Bob Steele was the one who was deciding to close these schools, because it just seemed that way to a lot of kids as they were growing up, you know, that this is what it, Bob Steele says, the schools are closed, you know.
Now, these are no school announcements. Meriden, public and parochial. Avon, public schools. Berlin, public and parochial. Bloomfield, public and parochial. Bolton Public, Bristol Public and Parochial, Cheshire.
We used to pray after every snowstorm.
Geoff Bell.
In the 50s and 60s, come on, Newington, New Britain, Hartford, Plainville, Southington. Newington starts at 10 o'clock. Like, oh!
Well, he was just legendary. He probably had the largest listenership of any morning host in any market in the country.
And it was tremendous. Nobody like him.
We would get mail addressed to Bob Steele, United States, from Europe, and he would get it. That simple of an address. That's how widely known he was.
I never heard of anyone dinging a hum. So, but if there is somebody who does that, then he would be a humdinger, whatever kind of activity that is. Well, so much for all that. I just wanted to report that I had received a letter. I want to brag a little bit. Sometimes you get two or three letters in 1 week here.
It was unsurpassed then, and I don't think anybody's touched him today.
The TIC cumes in the morning, I mean, it was staggering what they had. Before the advent of FM, they used to have million cumes in the morning. I mean, it was just amazing the audiences that radio station had. So, a million people. Throughout the morning, used to listen to TIC AM.
I mean, there are 35 signals in Hartford today.
Bob Dunn.
Back then, TIC had, Bob Steele had 50 shares.
And he was a competition for everybody in this state. He was such an institution at WTIC.
The station was doing, the AM station alone was doing 52 cents out of every dollar that was spent in radio was going to TIC. And six or seven other stations were going after the other 48 cents.
This forecast was brought to you by Allegheny Airlines, with the only direct fan jet service from Bradley International to Evansville. An 8:15 a.m. hot breakfast fan jet. WTIC, AM and FM in Hartford, the time 8:30. We'll look at sports in just a moment.
He was an unbeatable institution. All you could do is hope to be second place to someone like him. There was no way you could knock down the size of his audience and his popularity.
What Bob did, he did better than anybody else.
Ted Delacou.
And I mean anybody else. I mean just anybody else in Hartford. I mean anybody else in many places. Bob knew exactly what he was doing every time. He was very professional about it. He knew exactly what his market wanted to hear, what his listeners wanted to hear, and he knew how to motivate them, and he knew how to talk to them, and he knew how to tell stories. And he's a great raconteur, and I came to appreciate tremendously what his talent was.
Now in color, here is the early edition of the Channel 3 News with your newscaster, Bruce Kern.
Good evening. There was a plea from Connecticut today for those who are pushing a draft senator.
Dick Bertel.
Two of my favorite people are Bruce Kern and Ed Anderson. They epitomized for me the staff announcer.
Bruce Kern, a very capable individual, sounding like the old Stentorian network.
Bob Ellsworth.
With a wonderful deep voice and a tremendous capability. When he gave a station break, all the world would tremble.
WTIC. Hartford.
Just wonderful resonance.
WTIC-FM, Hartford, Connecticut.
And he took it that seriously.
Good morning and welcome to the stereophonic sounds of popular music on a stereo spectacular. Familiar recorded melodies featuring some of the outstanding orchestras and artists of America and the world. Our program this morning opens with Ray Anthony's orchestra playing It's Such a Happy Day.
Bruce came to that station in 1937, okay?
Okay.
He told me that at 6 o'clock at night, they were expected to put on tuxedos.
And for radio?
Yes. And those announcers, perhaps up until about 1939 or so, after 6 o'clock, wore tails. If you can imagine. That's what radio was like in those days. You know, it was incredible. And I don't think anybody saw them. But if anybody came up to the station, they were expected to look the part.
Ed Anderson, who used to work with Gene Colbert in the morning show and sort of keep her on track. And Gene did a woman show in the morning. And
former WTIC engineer, Dick Zwerko.
Ed Anderson was an announcer who worked with her.
Ed was just an incredible, versatile announcer.
Dick Bertel.
Ed arrived at the station, I think, in 1940, and he could do just about anything. He was a great staff announcer, newscaster, actor. I mean, he played on that Wrightville Clarion, you know. His greatest claim to fame was the coverage of the St. Joseph Cathedral fire in 1956. I think it was on December 31st. I've never heard anything like it in my life. It was as though it were scripted.
We cannot make any predictions here, but we can make comparisons. Compared to when we first arrived on the scene, the smoke has increased in intensity. There is deep red flame inside the building. It is rolling, the smoke that is, slowly up over the dome of the rear of the cathedral into this December sky, which is registering a temperature of 16 degrees at this time during the day. A light snow flurry is falling and thus hampering to some extent the firemen, although they have earlier stated that they didn't have the hardship that they did Saturday night when battling the St. Patrick's fire. Now, line of holes that I can see going up one of the aerial ladders on which are perched four firemen.
It was so beautifully done, and his description was so incredible.
It is now raging out of control. The Hartford firemen seem to have lost this battle to save the 64-year-old cathedral. Flames are pouring out both sides up the top. The dome, which is now encased in thick, heavy, towering smoke, rising cumbersomely into the air, is lined also with the red of the eager, hungry flames which lick up through it.
I thought to myself, I was back at the studio listening to this, and I thought, I'm not in his league. I am so lucky to be working here because I couldn't do that. But he did.
Floyd Richards was an institution there.
Former WTIC engineer, Bob Scherago.
He'd been there in the 40s as a radio announcer.
My first job was in Lawrence, Massachusetts, and I was there at WLAW for a year, and a friend of mine, a brother announcer, and I decided we wanted to move on, and he got a job in Louisville, Kentucky, and I got my job at WTIC in Hartford.
And it was interesting. He worked a very early morning shift. He was in at about 5:30 in the morning for his 8-hour shift as an announcer on Bob Steele's show and doing news and other sundry duties.
It's 8 a.m. and time for WTIC's Worldwide News, brought to you by CLNP, Helco, Holyoke Water Power, and Western Mass Electric.
You did everything then. You came in the morning, you did a newscast, and you might do a ladies' cooking show along with somebody else.
Bob Tyrol and gentlemen that a lot of us will remember fondly, along with Ranger Andy from Channel 3, Hap Richards, Floyd Richards.
Radio historian Bob Paine.
Did a program from 47 to 51, and it was called Cinderella Weekend.
It was a quiz show for women in the morning.
And welcome to Cinderella Weekend. This is Bob Tyrol and my old partner.
Well, thank you. May I take over?
You got it, brother.
Okay. We have a presentation of Cinderella Weekend from our Cinderella studio in downtown Hartford. As you know, it's a great day again, Friday. Time to crown our grand Cinderella, present her with a lovely new ensemble, and send her off to a wonderful weekend in New York with a companion of her choice. We have with us today the ladies who were winners on the four preceding days this week. Our Monday Cinderella, Mrs. Marion Ridley, Tuesday's time winner, Mrs. Margie Fritzen, Wednesday's Wonder Woman, Mrs. Nettie Merva, and Thursday's topper, Mrs. Emily Brown. One of these lovely ladies will be our silver anniversary Cinderella.
And at first we did it at a restaurant on Pearl Street in Hartford, and we'd have four women on every day and ask them questions. And this is Bob Tyrol and I. And the winner of that day would team up with the winners of Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. And on Friday, the four winners would appear, and we'd have the finals. And the winner got a trip to New York and a complete wardrobe from a store that was on Pearl Street in Hartford. It was called Worth's, and it was very well received. It was the first time, I think, in the area that type of quiz show had been aired.
The great music of the great musical South Pacific. That was the overture with the original cast orchestra here on WTIC-FM in Hartford, Connecticut, presenting the music of Curtain Time.
And you did a music show where they played records, and you had to write your own script, and you did everything.
And then he would come back
at 11 o'clock at night to do a five-minute sports show on the radio. A lot of the announcers did that. They would come back for a show after their regular shift.
And that was the one where he had one of the cleverest sign-offs, I think.
Arnold Dean.
Especially in the dead of winter. He'd say, "That's the sports for tonight. This is Floyd Richards. And remember, only 14 more days till the trout fishing season opens." And the next night it would be 13 and 12.
Well, that'll have to be it for this March Friday in sports. Now only 42 days before the start of the trout fishing season. Over the weekend, others will keep you informed, and I'll be with you again on Monday night at 11:25 with another sports final. This is Floyd Richards.
And he did a kids' TV show.
In TV, I did the Hap Richards show. It was a show for the preschool children, so it was a little difficult to get yourself in that age group, being of my age. And I had to talk to young people who were in the 4-, 5-, and 6-year-olds. But it was fun, and I enjoyed good popularity with it.
Arnold Dean.
George Malcolm, and they'd whistle Smith. That was right. For the little hyphen in his name.
George Malcolm Smith was just a wonderful person.
Lloyd Richards.
And very friendly to everybody, and so well-known in the field of big band music.
And he was a public relations guy who wrote a thing called The Traveler's Beacon.
Bill Hennessey.
He also did a program on Saturday nights called Gems of American Jazz.
Gems of American Jazz. Out of the night comes the wail of an eerie trumpet. The witching hour is upon us, and so too is that voice from the groove, our zealous zombie of Zazuzaz, Mr. George Malcolm Smith.
Thank you, Peter Stoner, for that felicitous sentiment. And a happy Saturday night, September the 9th, to you kind listeners. This evening, with your gracious indulgence, your potty professor would like to devote his records and remarks to a topic that has too long been postponed in this little Chautauqua of ours. The subject is the blues.
I was his announcer. He had a program every Saturday evening that went from after the 11 o'clock news until 12 o'clock when we signed off. And he had all the well-known recordings of the famous bands of the time. And at that time, usually on a Saturday night, and that's when his program was, when it was aired, there would be a famous band being played at the State Theater in Hartford. The Benny Goodmans and Tommy Dorsey and Glenn Miller and all. And he'd always have somebody up there and interview them, and I was the announcer, so I had a chance to take part in the interviews.
Well, if the old wax museum didn't weld away after that one, I guess it's here to stay. That, in case we neglected to mention it, was Count Basie and his band giving the once-over lightly to an energetic nocturne entitled Swingin' the Blues. And now, if he can find his way through the ruins, your old wax head will be heading for the Farmington Avenue Gilt Edge Express. So, regretfully as always, good night.
And I so well remember the time he had Tommy Dorsey on, and we went through the whole interview, and afterwards, after we signed off the station, we went downstairs, and George's daughter met him and took him home, and Dorsey said, "Where do you live?" And at that time, I lived out on Willard Street, which was off Asylum Avenue, and he said, "Well, where's your car?" I said, "Well, I take the bus." And he says, "I'll give you a ride." Here it is, like 12:15, 12:30 in the morning, and Tommy Dorsey in this big white convertible gave me a ride home. And do you think anybody in the whole wide world saw me? I told my wife, I said, "Guess who gave me a ride home last night?" And she said, "Who?" And I said, "Tommy Dorsey." She said, "Oh, fine." And that was the end of that conversation.
Ross Miller.
Bob Ellsworth.
One of the finest all-around general knowledge people that you could ever want. Ross Miller was very heavy in what we call special events.
The Bradley Field Airfare. This is Ross Miller speaking from the speaker's platform. The sixth in a series of 8 airfares held in Connecticut this year to celebrate the 50th anniversary of powered flight, honoring that first flight made by the Wright brothers from the sand dunes of Kitty Hawk, North Carolina in 1903.
Ross was 19 when he was hired in 1945.
Dick Bertel.
By WTIC. And he developed a kind of a disc jockey image for himself. I would listen to him doing a Saturday afternoon show around 1:30 in the afternoon, had his own theme song, customized theme song, the Ross Miller Show, you know, oh boy, it was classy. And so when I got there, Ross was a staff announcer. He was doing the afternoon program, I think from 4 to 6 in the afternoon.
Arnold Dean.
Yeah, he was the program director and not on the air by the time I came.
Right.
The best kind of person to work with, a beautiful disposition, a keen sense of radio.
Wonderful gentleman, by the way. Yeah. One of the truly great people God put on this earth, Ross Miller. I remember once I had broken up on the air, and he called me into the office. The only reason that Ross was not a good boss, he couldn't come down hard on anybody. I walked in. He said, "Arnold, I'm very disappointed. You know what it's like here. You can't break up on the air. What exactly happened anyway?" And I said, "Oh, Ross, I got to tell you." And I started to tell him the story of what broke me up. And the more I told, the more he laughed. He's bent over the desk, stamping his hand on the desk, laughing away and saying, "Oh, I can understand how you, but you're not supposed to break up. Now, I have to tell you, and I mean this, too." Just a wonderful man.
Broadcasting as a community service of the University of Hartford, this is WWUH West Hartford, WAPJ Torrington, WDJW Summers, and WWEB Wallingford. And now back to Connecticut Radio Memories.
Good morning, everybody, and a beautiful, happy good morning, and, well, a wonderful day.
Former WTIC engineer, Dick Zwerko.
Jean Colver did a woman's show in the morning. And
well, she was a beautiful woman.
Longtime WTIC receptionist, Kay Mahoney.
And she's very bright, and she had a wonderful program, a great following.
Hello, this is Jean Colbert. This morning at 11:05, my guest will be Hollis Alpert. Mr. Hollis Alpert is one of the finest motion picture critics in the United States. You will also meet his wife, Joan Alpert, a well-known artist. And then we have invited Mr. Marvin Rosen, an expert on home sewing. So please do remember this morning at 11:05. Thank you.
Jean was wonderful.
Dick Bertel.
She was one of the most professional people you could ever possibly work with. Ed Anderson was her announcer, and he was excellent at that. But she was a pro.
We should like to have you meet Mr. Jerry Damon. Mr. Damon is the NBC announcer who hopes to buy Ellis Island. Believe it or not, we think he'll make it.
And they used to kid us all about buying the Brooklyn Bridge.
Well, I want to tell you something. He has all the plans for Ellis Island. He has everything drawn up, everything but the checks to pay for
it. A very ambitious scheme.
Well, as you know, I am in California at the moment, and I must say that I took out a great many presents for my daughter and for my son and for the new baby, and they were bought at G. Fox & Company. Shopping at G. Fox & Company, I think, is always a joy, but right now, with every department bursting with new spring arrivals, shopping really is a wonderful adventure. Treat yourself to the fun of early spring shopping at G. Fox & Company and have luncheon this noon at the Hotel Statler Hilton to see the G. Fox fashion show. Make a day of it, won't you, at that great, great store in downtown Hartford.
The secret of her success was the amount of travel that she could do.
Bob Ellsworth.
And wherever she went, she got perfect reservations, perfect people lined up, and so she would bring back great interviews with big names in the women's world as well as the world in general, whether it was entertainment, fashion, or geopolitical. She would bring all those names to the fore with us, so her interviews were extremely interesting. She just loved it. She got her start in network radio drama on the NBC staff and all the rest of it. No, she came from the network.
This is Jean Colbert wishing all of you a pleasant afternoon. Meet us tomorrow at 2:05. Our guest will be the Reverend Mr. John Webster, who will talk about the Senior Citizens Center, and Mr. Gar Gilbert of Galien Lord, who will talk about the cotton collection. This is Jean Colbert signing off and saying goodbye.
Hello again, this is Floyd Richards.
And this is Dick Bertel, and this is Mike Lyon. The phone numbers are 527-4188. And if you're in Meriden or Wallingford or up in Springfield, Massachusetts, the Enterprise line is 9842.
When I joined WTIC in 1956, there was no television station, so it was strictly radio.
Dick Bertel.
And you would work perhaps 6 hours a day in AM and perhaps 2 hours a day on the FM side.
Time out now for news, followed by the weather forecast, and then it's curtain time. Good music here on WTIC-FM right through the afternoon and evening. Stay tuned, won't you, and have a good cold day.
FM was classical music, so that's where the classical music was important. You had to know those pronunciations and be able to, reel them off when you had to.
Mm-hmm.
But the rest of the time was in AM, and you would be remember, there were also network radio programs still being fed from NBC,
okay.
So we had a whole lineup of radio shows, during the day, soap operas during the day, and dramas and comedy shows at night. And my job would be the staff announcer. I would come in after the NBC chimes and give the call letters and perhaps read a 25-second commercial, something like that. If you can imagine this, we would have three announcers in a studio, in a very small studio. The NBC chimes would ring. Announcer A would read the station break and commercial. Announcer B would introduce the newscaster. And announcer C would read the news. That's the way it worked.
It's 6 o'clock, and here's WTIC News, your newscaster, Dick Bertel. First in the news, indictments against Vietnam War protesters Dr. Spock and Yale chaplain William Sloan Coffin.
And those newscasts were difficult. They were 15-minute newscasts without the benefit of actualities. You read 15 minutes of news, and you had better read it right.
WTIC presents a special edition of Dick Bertel's Americana.
The sound of the meeting house bell, summoning the villagers to services on a Thanksgiving morning more than 150 years ago. This is Dick Bertel at Old Sturbridge Village, Massachusetts. Today we're going to relive that special day as our forefathers would have celebrated it. Thanksgiving was New England's greatest holiday, and it is also New England's greatest contribution to American holidays.
Yeah, Americana was the show that I guess I developed. That ran from, I believe, 2 o'clock until 3:30 in the afternoon, Monday through Friday. And what I did there was to interview people. I would interview authors, and mostly with an Americana twist. For example, if a person had written a book about an American revolutionary hero, he would surely be a guest, that sort of thing. And I would record perhaps an hour with each of these people, and then break it up into segments, which would be played over a period of 5 days or so. And I would end the interview on Monday and say, now tomorrow our guest will be back, and we're going to talk about this aspect of his book, that sort of thing. And then we'd pick it up, and it seemed to work. I received a phone call probably in 1965 or thereabouts from a fellow who said that he had a collection of old-time radio programs. Now, that doesn't seem unusual today. But you can buy them on the Internet, you can buy them in bookstores. But in 1965, we were about, 15 years removed from that era. And nobody had any of these shows. Well, this was Ed Corcoran on the phone. And I became intrigued with the idea of being able to play some of these old shows, at least parts of them, on the air. We more or less decided that we would do this on a regular basis, a semi-regular basis anyway. And so he would come in and maybe do a half-hour show with us on the anniversary of WTIC's founding, February 10th. And sometime I would have him on the afternoon edition.
Mm-hmm.
I'd have him on for about 5 minutes, and we'd play a little excerpt from some old show, that sort of thing. And suddenly it dawned on me, about 1970, that we had the makings of a full-hour show here if we could only get the live guests, the people who actually did these broadcasts.
Right.
And so in April of 1970, we put the first show on the air, and it was live. Then, I don't know what happened, but we began to attract big names. I mean, we had only the best. We had Don Ameche. We had Edgar Bergen.
Ed, I'm anxious to meet Edgar Bergen.
Well, Dick, it's my pleasure to present to you Mr. Edgar Bergen.
Well, thank you, Ed. It's always nice to say hello to radio friends, because I got some pretty loyal friends there across the country that were very nice to me through the years.
I had taken an audition because...
Bob Ellsworth.
Again, I wanted to improve my professional position, and TIC had always been my objective because in those days, announcers wanted to be successful and pointed toward the nearest 50,000-watt station that they could get hired in. Once you were at that level, you'd stay there, either at that station or move on to another one. Bob Steele introduced me to the Hartford audience. He was very wonderful as his morning host. Position called for. He played at the time I had a nationally distributed children's record called The King's Trumpet. He played it that morning and introduced me and said, this young man is now going to join our WTIC staff. So, you know, it was a nice way to come into Hartford. And then in the ensuing years, I would come to work with him very often.
Let's talk a little bit about different kind of things he did at TIC. Duties of a staff announcer and different shows you hosted?
The best quick answer for you is everything. I mean, when they hired you and you were hired with all the faith in the world in you, then you were expected to immediately take over whatever they offered you or whatever they said this was what you're going to... In those days, we still had directors for every live show, and we had an engineer, and that was, you know, you in the studio on one side of the glass. And when you did a newscast, you did a 15-minute newscast several times a day. Then I got my own radio show, and I did that for several years. Let's see, I would follow the Bob Steele show. Bob was up to about 9, 10 o'clock. I would come in somewhere around there, and I had a pretty good audience on my program for a number of years, and I went through the noon hour, and I did recipes and talk and music, and I integrated my piano with the program, too. So I would come out of a commercial in the same key on the keyboard that, you know, that
so you had a piano in the studio then.
Oh, TIC had two Steinway Grands.
Oh, wow.
And a Celeste.
Hi, this is Floyd Richards. Well, I'm not usually here on Friday, but it's a pleasure to be with you on a Friday afternoon for Mike Line. And in to join me in just a moment, I believe, will be a surprise. Bob Ellsworth, you say, huh? Well, he's not sending any record for the dash here, but anyway, we'll be here from now until 2 o'clock, and here he comes. Hey, golly, you're not as fast as you used to be there, buddy.
When you're going through the halls and there are things like doors sticking out, you may never be fast again. Hi.
Hello there. Well, I said we were here from now until 2. I forgot to give the phone numbers, which are most important.
We were talking about Mike Line, and let's recount that day.
Well, the bad part of it was we were in the middle of getting this interchange, as I was explaining to you, between the audience and ourselves, where we would ask them on the air, you know, we'd get a call or we had a request for how to remove a stain or how do you acquire this or what's a recipe for that. And we were coming up on this next call, which involved a woman who was going to give a recipe for a chocolate cake. I mean, how domestic can you get? Right. And in the middle of this, and isn't that so indicative of our business? You know, you don't know where you're going to be when something is going to be a news break, as they call it today.
Right. Floyd Richards.
And the newsman rushed in with something off the news machine.
And that's what we got. I was sitting there, and the news people got this, obviously, on the wire, and they came into the studio. This was in Broadcast House, and handed it to me, because Floyd was on the air with somebody, and I signaled him, I said, we got a break. I just scanned it and I said, whoa.
When is the best time to trim young maple trees?
Floyd, I have something rather important from the WTIC newsroom in a form of a bulletin. President Kennedy is reported to have been wounded by an assassin in Dallas, Texas. There are no further details available at this time. We repeat, President Kennedy has been wounded by an assassin in Dallas, Texas. We will have further details as received. I'm sure everybody joins us in deploring this regretful news.
Oh, I should think
so. We'll bring details as soon as we possibly can.
We certainly will. We'll stay right on top of that. Yeah.
This was pretty heavy, and it preyed very heavily on all of us.
President Kennedy has been shot in Texas, and, you know, what more can you say? It was a one-line thing, and you were expected to stay on the air and say something until they could find more information.
So Floyd tried to encourage us to carry on.
All right, let's see if we can continue on with Mike Line here while awaiting any more news from our newsroom. Hello?
Oh, golly, isn't that awful?
It certainly is.
Well, I got the recipe. This is Roz Fishman.
Yes, Roz. Okay.
Oh, my. I just took my breath away.
Did ours, too.
And so.
Well, one package, it's for the, with the German sweet chocolate.
Yes, yes.
One package of the German sweet chocolate.
German sweet chocolate. Okay.
Oh, I can't even get my breath. My goodness.
And when we came in, the lady said, well, I just can't. He said, well, I understand. So we let her go. And from there, it elevated into NBC right. local coverage combination, and we went on to the matter at hand, which within short minutes, confirmation was that Kennedy had been indeed assassinated.
Over the decades, WTIC's news staff has covered many major events. What follows is a montage of archival audio and recollections of WTIC coverage, from tragedies like the Hartford Circus Fire, the 1955 flood, the Kennedy assassination, and the 1965 Northeast Blackout, to triumphs such as the homecoming of American aircrews from Europe near the end of World War II, and the 50th anniversary of powered flight to the first landing of men on the moon.
6 o'clock edition from the WTIC newsroom, brought to you tonight by Griffin, the greatest name in shoe polish.
Hello, everyone. Well, Hartford this afternoon suffered one of the greatest catastrophes in its history when during a matinee performance of Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey Circus, the big tent suddenly burst into flame and burned to the ground, causing more than 100 deaths.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Bob Steele of WTIC Hartford speaking to you from the Army's Bradley Field in central Connecticut, where 25 or 30 big four-engine bombers have arrived in the past hour or so. More are coming in all the time. From Europe, B-17s and B-24s of the 8th and 15th Air Force heavy bombardment groups of the European Theater of Operations and the Mediterranean Theater. It's the first organized landing of four-engine bombers in the United States under the redeployment plan, and in each plane are the crew of 10 and up to 10 additional passengers who are right now setting foot on the soil of the United States of America for the first time since they left these shores to fight the air war in Europe. They're here for the 3 R's. Rehabilitation, recuperation, and recovery, and are being processed here at Bradley Field in one of the field's big hangar-like buildings, and then most of them will be sent to fight the Jap. Some, of course, will be discharged, but the big part of them will push on, and they're coming out of the big building now, having been processed, and here's the first man, a big, husky-looking guy, about 200 pounds, and I would say 5'10 or 5'11, right close to 6 feet. What is your name, sir?
Charles Connor.
Charles Connor, where do you live, Charlie?
Homestead, Florida.
Homestead, Florida. And how long were you over?
17 months.
17 months. Does your ship have a nickname, the one you came in on, Charlie?
It sure does. It's Lucky Girls, Here We Are.
Lucky Girls, Here We Are. How does it feel to get those feet on this here ground of ours?
I feel like kissing it.
It should be to us a source of enduring pride and satisfaction that Mr. Rentschler and his associates selected Connecticut as the site of this nationally significant industry. I might say that I was tremendously interested in the remarks of the Assistant Secretary of Defense, Mr. Thomas, and I would like to add just one thing to what he said about why there is this great concentration of industry in Connecticut. There are many reasons, and he has enumerated some of the most significant, but there is another reason, and that is that we do maintain in our state a healthy climate for industry. We do maintain in our state unexcelled state services for the people who come to live here. And there are only 3 states in the United States which have a lower tax structure than we have.
Governor John Lodge of Connecticut, who presented a special medal to Frederick B. Rentschler, chairman of United Aircraft, East Hartford. The music by the governor's Foot Guard Band. This is Ross Miller speaking from Bradley Field.
Upon arriving in Unionville, we were informed that there was a family of 5 people stranded on a housetop out in a swift current. They tried to get boats to them, but it was impossible because of the water rushing by the house. The only way we could get our helicopter in was to let a line float toward the houses. The house was jammed under a tree, and it made it impossible for the Bell helicopter to hover above the house and drop a line.
Oh, well, in just a moment, yes, now, we will go to NBC for later news on the happening at Dallas.
You can understand our confusion at this point.
So stay with us, and in just a moment, I'm sure NBC will have more details on the assassin's attempt on President Kennedy in Dallas earlier this afternoon.
Dianasport, Massachusetts, President Kennedy's mother and father have been advised that their son was shot in Dallas. They are in Dianasport, Massachusetts. 2 Roman Catholic priests have been summoned to the emergency room where the president is. A White House spokesman said someone had asked for the priests. This news from the WTIC newsroom.
A note just handed me from the WTIC newsroom. President Johnson has been told that utility workers hope to restore power to all affected areas by about 10 o'clock tonight. It's now 8:57. Repeating, President Johnson has been told that utility workers hope to restore power to all affected areas in the Northeast by about 10 o'clock tonight. In Connecticut, some towns and cities report power has already been restored while others remain dark. Dick, we did check out at Bradley Field. We know that there developed some immediate difficulty at LaGuardia and Kennedy International Airports, where although the towers did have auxiliary lights, which came into being immediately, the field was without lights, and three flights were diverted to Bradley.
We're going to switch. I think I'll open my mic first, Stan. We're going to switch now to Larry DeBear at the governor's office.
Right, Dick. We're here at Governor Dempsey's office at the state capitol. The governor arrived at around 7:15 tonight. Shortly thereafter, State Police Commissioner Leo Mulcahy, State Civil Defense Director William Shatner.
Parades North and South Vietnam, hitting two South Vietnamese outposts. On the political scene, the danger of civil war grows as government troops and dissident forces exchange gunfire in the city of Da Nang.
It's 11 o'clock, and this is WTIC News, your newscaster, Jim Thompson.
Good evening. In the news at this hour, four American helicopters are downed in the Mekong Delta.
Good evening. In the news at this hour, the Apollo 11 moon mission is doing superbly. President Nixon calls Monday a national day of participation. On the day of participation called for by the president, Monday, all federal offices will be closed, and Mr. Nixon is urging all governors and private employers to free their employees so that they may share in the day's events. Connecticut's Governor John Dempsey has lauded the Apollo 11 moon landing mission. He says the mission is a unique voyage which compares with the most historic explorations of all time.
Now your newscaster, Al Terzi. Good morning. The White House has until 10 o'clock this morning to hand over hundreds of tapes and documents subpoenaed by the Senate Watergate Committee.
WTIC World and National News brought to you this morning by Sage Allen, Hartford, East Hartford, West Hartford, Wethersfield, Old Saybrook, Windsor, Vernon, Enfield, and Avon Simsbury.
Now here's regional and local news. Ed Anderson reporting. Senator Lowell Weicker said last night that the president's Operation Candor did a disservice to the Republican Party by connecting all Republicans to the Watergate affair.
I can remember one very specific thing of importance.
Charlie Bagley.
And that was when the roof on the Civic Center collapsed. Everyone said the reason it collapsed was it was the snow that was on top of it. And I can remember we were having a storm that night. I stayed downtown at the Sonesta to be able to go in early the next morning. And Jerry Wilson was on duty. He called me, I believe it was at 4 o'clock, and said the Civic Center roof just collapsed.
I was home in bed when they called from the station.
Dana Whelan.
And said that the roof had collapsed. I needed to head in. We'd had a lot of snow all that winter, over and over, storms hitting one on top of the other. And I had literally taken the bus home and left my car at the office. So I started to walk in through this heavy snow. I lived about 2 miles away. And, you know, finally I got about halfway and one of the early buses came along because, you know, it was, you know, 4:35 o'clock in the morning at that point. And, you know, got in, you know, started making phone calls, started taking phone calls. Our reporter, Alan Sagel, went over, and after a few hours, they kind of let people in a little bit to see it. Because it had been so bad, some of the staff members had been staying at what was then the Hartford Sheraton, it's now the Hilton, and had rooms that kind of overlooked it. So some of them were able to call in and tell us what they were able to see, because nobody outside, inside, anywhere could kind of believe. It just seemed unreal.
So we did a great study on it. We went back and we made the worst possible assumptions, saying that, okay, for every flake of snow that fell this year up until that date, what if it didn't melt? How much would the weight on the roof have been? And I can remember this because I was deeply involved in it. And the weight was something like 16.2 pounds per square foot. The roof was supposed to be structured so it could stand 80 pounds per square feet of weight. So it wasn't the snow that knocked it down. It was a poor design feature. Granted, the last snowflake was enough to do it, but the roof had been woefully under-designed to handle the strength.
You know, a lot of people, of course, had been at the, I think it was UConn-UMass basketball game not that long before.
UMass played UConn down there. The game probably got over 11 o'clock, and maybe it was 2 o'clock when it came down, 2 o'clock or 4 o'clock. I think it was 2 o'clock, really. And talking to some of the fellows in the Hartford Police Department, they said if there were people in there at the time, everybody from the walkway, you know, halfway up the Civic Center, there's a walkway all around. They said everyone below that walkway would have been killed. Just, you know, the whole thing would have just crushed everyone in there.
Bill Flower recalls the news staff when he started in the late 1960s.
We had a good staff. We had six full-time people and occasionally a couple of part-timers. We had a news director who was a true news director. He wasn't on the air. He wasn't pulling an air shift, although he would pull an air shift when he needed to.
There have been scores of reporters and newscasters at WTIC over the years. Here are just a few of them.
Your newscaster, Joe Duran.
Good evening. In the news, Kennedy cautions national banking powers not to raise prime interest rate.
Your newscaster, Bill Hansen.
Good evening. In the news tonight, 75 persons arrested in Charleston, South Carolina hospital strike demonstration.
To Alan Siegel.
Hello, Ted, and good afternoon, everyone. 2 o'clock, 60 degrees, the WTIC 1080 in-town weather. A few showers this afternoon, high in the 60s. A traveler's forecast follows the news.
Here is Al Terzi.
Good evening, everyone. In the news tonight, the non-proliferation treaty is one step closer.
Good evening. This is Norm Peters with WTIC News at 11 o'clock.
And now, Bryant Thomas and the news.
Thank you, Bob. Good morning, everyone. It is 8 o'clock and 41 degrees. Former EPA official Rita Lavelle has an appointment with the Congress today to testify before a House subcommittee about the hazardous waste cleanup operation.
WTIC, and now with a look at some of the morning's top stories, here's Angela Dias.
The Clinton-Gore ticket hits the road. Now that Bill Clinton has accepted the Democratic presidential nomination, he and running mate Al Gore, along with their wives, leave on an eight-state bus tour today. First stop, Camden, New Jersey.
Walt Dibble at WTIC.
Richard Price.
A legendary newsman. I think he worked in Stamford originally, then he moved up to the Hartford area. He worked at WDRC. I think he was the news director there and then moved over to WTIC and was at WTIC until he passed away.
Walt Dibble was on scene and talked with Angela Jones of the group called United to Save Our Homes.
Are people actually losing their homes over this property tax differential?
An awful lot of people will lose their homes in Hartford.
Walt was a pro from start to finish. He knew the business. He knew how it was done. He knew the people. He had sources out in the community and people he could go to. And he was all radio and he was all news.
Former engineer Bob Scherago.
The time tone on the hour was V in Morse code.
Yeah.
It still rings in my head for some reason.
The V for Victory, which echoes the notes for Beethoven's Fifth Symphony.
Geoff Hugabonne.
The last note, the da, lands on the top of the hour. The first units were, as I understand from the engineering files, was a cam-driven vacuum tube affair that was in service for many years up until the late 60s.
So the ancient contraption that created that was a tone oscillator with built-in distortion and a mechanical device that would cause the three short tones and one long tone to sound. Well, one day that broke, and we no longer had a time tone, and everybody was in a panic. So Bill Kalutsch, who was an engineer at the time, was able to build it using solid-state components, and he analyzed the sound from recordings, I guess, and was able to duplicate that raspy mechanical sound using electronic components. And we thought that was quite miraculous.
Most recently, the incarnation of the time tone is a completely solid-state, integrated circuit, custom time tone system that is actually much more complex. It's actually sort of a hybridized two-time tone system that's fired directly from our GPS master clock. There are offsets circuits in there that are designed to compensate for the broadcast delays that we use, a profanity delay, and now we have a new delay for our HD radio system. All of that stuff was spec'd out by me, but designed locally here by a serendipity as a previous chief engineer of WTIC, Larry Titus, who owns a great broadcast products company in Glastonbury called Titus Technological Labs. And Larry did a wonderful job designing a new time tone for us. So the time tone lives on. It really is sort of like the Northern Star with WTIC. You know, it's been in continuous operation all those years. And now with the GPS-fired technology, it's more accurate than ever.
This program is dedicated to the great Bob Steele and to those who participated in interviews but who passed away before the program was finished. Bob Ellsworth, Lonnie Jerev, Charlie Bagley, Kay Mahoney, Floyd Richards, Jack Lenhoff, Arnold Dean, John Reno, Fred Swanson.
Come and listen in to the radio station where the mighty hosts of heaven sing. Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on.
Turn your radio on. Turn your radio on.
You've been listening to Connecticut Radio Memories, Episode 3. This program was produced and edited by Brandon Camp. Thanks to everyone who participated in interviews for this series, including those whose comments didn't make it to air. Interviews were edited for time, continuity, and clarity. Special thanks to WTIC News Talk 1080 and CBS Radio for allowing us to use archival audio, and to Jeff Hugabonne, the chief engineer of WTIC, who is also curator of their archives. Special thanks to David Kaplan, webmaster of the WTIC alumni website. Special thanks also to Phil Steele, who let us use excerpts from his 7-CD set, Bob Steele, A Voice for the Ages. This series would not have been possible without the air check collectors and other people and organizations who had the foresight to save air checks, jingles, or theme songs, and who shared them with us, including Ed Bruder from ManForMars.com, Rick Kelly of Northeast Air Checks, Bob Gilmore of Bob Gilmore's Air Checks, John Ramsey of HartfordRadioHistory.com, Jeff Hugabonne, Dick Bertel, David Kaplan, the Media Preservation Foundation, Tracy Carman, Doug Bain, the Library of Congress, Phil Steele, Bob Scherago, Arnold Dean, Wayne Norman, Ken and Bonnie Beatrice, and Barbara Manstan. We want to send a shout-out to Bill Hennessey and the bunch of old broadcasters who meet monthly to hear the Hartford Jazz Orchestra play at the Arch Street Tavern. Special thanks also to John Ramsey. Connecticut Radio Memories was produced at the studios of WWUH-FM at the University of Hartford.
Turn your radio on, turn your radio on, and listen to the music in the air.
Turn your radio on,
turn your radio on.
Have the glory share.
Turn the lights down low.
Turn your lights down low.
Radio.